Penguin Random House Audio presents A Burning by Megha Majumdar. Read for you by Vikas Adam, Priya Ayyar, Deepti Gupta, Ulka Mohanty, Soneela Nankani, and Neil Shah.
Jeevan, you smell like smoke, my mother said to me. So I rubbed an oval of soap in my hair and poured a whole bucket of water on myself before a neighbor complained that I was wasting the morning supply. There was a curfew that day. On the main street, a police jeep would creep by every half hour. Daily wage laborers, compelled to work, would come home with arms raised to show they had no weapons. In bed, my wet hair spread on the pillow, I picked up my new phone, purchased with my own salary, screen guard still attached. On Facebook, there was only one conversation. These terrorists attacked the wrong neighborhood. Hashtag Kolabagan train attack. Hashtag undefeated. Friends, if you have 50 rupees, skip your samosas today and donate to... The more I scrolled, the more Facebook unrolled. This news clip, exclusively from 24 hours, shows how... Candlelight vigil at... The night before, I had been at the railway station, no more than a 15-minute walk from my house. I ought to have seen the men who stole up to the open windows and threw flaming torches into the halted train, but all I saw were carriages, burning, their doors locked from the outside, and dangerously hot. The fire spread to huts bordering the station, smoke filling the chests of those who lived there. More than 100 people died. The government promised compensation to the families of the dead. 80,000 rupees, which, well, the government promises many things. In a video, to the dozen microphones thrust at his chin, the chief minister was saying, "Let the authorities investigate." Somebody had spliced this comment with a video of policemen scratching their heads. It made me laugh. I admired these strangers on Facebook who said anything they wanted to. They were not afraid of making jokes. Whether it was about the police or the ministers, they had their fun. And wasn't that freedom? I hoped that after a few more salary slips, after I rose to be a senior sales clerk of pantaloons, I would be free in that way too. Then, in a video clip further down the page, a woman came forward, her hair flying, her nose running a wet trail down to her lips, her eyes red. She was standing on the sloping platform of our small railway station. Into the microphone, she screamed, "There was a jeep full of policemen right there! Ask them why they stood around and watched while my husband burned. He tried to open the door and save my daughter. He tried and tried." I shared that video. I added a caption. Policemen paid by the government watched and did nothing while this innocent woman lost everything, I wrote. I laid the phone next to my head and dozed. The heat brought sleep to my eyes. When I checked my phone next, there were only 2 likes. A half hour later, still 2 likes. Then, a woman, I don't know who, commented on my post. "How do you know this person is not faking it? Maybe she wants attention." I sat up. Was I friends with this person? In her profile picture, she was posing in a bathroom. "Did you even watch the video?" I replied. The words of the heartless woman drifted in my mind. I was irritated by her, but there was excitement too. This was not the frustration of no water in the municipal pump or power cut on the hottest night. Wasn't this a kind of leisure dressed up as agitation? For me, the day was a holiday after all. My mother was cooking fish so small we would eat them bones and tail. My father was taking in the sun. His back pain eased. Under my thumb, I watched post after post about the train attack earn 50 likes, 100 likes, 300 likes, Nobody liked my reply. And then, in the small glowing screen, I wrote a foolish thing. I wrote a dangerous thing, a thing nobody like me should ever think, let alone write. Forgive me, Ma. If the police didn't help ordinary people like you and me, if the police watched them die, doesn't that mean, I wrote on Facebook, that the government is also a terrorist? Outside the door, a man slowly pedaled his rickshaw, the only passenger his child, the horn going paw-paw for her glee.
Lovely. Sunday morning. Time to go to acting class. With my hips swinging like this and like that, I'm walking past the guava cellar. Brother, I'm calling. What's the time?
8:30,
he is grumbling, because he is not wishing to share with me the fruits of his wristwatch. Leave him. I'm abandoning my stylish walk and running like a horse to the local railway station. On the train, while I am touching my chest and forehead, saying a prayer for those poor people who were dying a few days ago at this very station. Who is pushing? One auntie is shouting. Stop it! This hijra couldn't find a different compartment to hassle. The peanut seller is hissing, as if I'm not having ears. Nothing is simple for a person like me. Not even 1 hour on the train. My chest is a man's chest, and my breasts are made of rags. So what? Find me another woman in this whole city as truly woman as me. In the middle of this crowd, a legless beggar is coming down the corridor, sitting on a wheeled plank of wood, which he is rolling on everybody's feet. Give me one coin, he is whining. People are yelling at him. Now you need to pass? No eyes or what? Where will I stand? On your head? Now he is also shouting back. Let me cut off your legs, then you see how you manage. It is true to God, making me laugh and laugh. This is why I am liking the local trains. You can be burning one train, but you cannot be stopping our will to go to work, to class, to family, if we have them. Every local train is like a film. On the train, I am observing faces, body movements, voices, fights. This is how people like me are learning. When this train is swaying, picking up speed, wind whipping my hair, I'm putting my fingertips on the ceiling, making my body straight and tall for Mr. Debnath's acting class. At Mr. Debnath's house, he is resting in a chair, drinking tea from a saucer. That way the tea is cooling fast and he is not having to do poo-poo. I have heard of acting coaches who are taking advantage of strugglers, but Mr. Debnath is not like that. He is having morals. In his younger days, he was getting a chance to direct a film himself, but the opportunity was in Bombay. So he was having to go to Bombay for 6 months minimum. At that time, his old mother was in a hospital. What kind of monster would abandon his mother to chase his dreams? So he was sacrificing his own goals and staying with his mother. When he was telling us this sad story, it was the only time I was seeing him cry. Next to his feet are sitting 6 other students. Brijesh, who is working as an electrician. Rumeli, who is selling magic ointment for rashes. Pyonji, who is working as a clerk in the insurance office. Radha, who is studying how to be a nurse. And Joita, who is doing bookkeeping in her father's pen refill business. Nobody is really sure what Kumar is doing because he is only laughing in answer to all questions. We are all saving and saving and handing over 50 rupees each class. Today in this living room, which is our stage, we are pushing the dining table to one side and practicing a scene in which a man is being suspicious of his wife. After some, if it can be said, lackluster performances, it is my turn. I'm placing my phone on the floor to record myself for study purposes, then going to the center of the room and rolling my neck, Left to right, right to left. Mr. Debnath's deceased parents, please to pray for them, are looking at me with strict faces from photos on the wall. I'm feeling hot, even though the fan is running on maximum speed. Time for my artistic performance.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.